And we're back. Oh my, this is still locked up though. Oh, you can't actually control C on Theta. So, is everyone ready to start back again? Okay, so command that makes this stuff pop up is called context. No, it's not. There we go. So, what we have here, see, how do you view the registers in Theta? I'm gonna do it a pretty way. But anyway, EBP is this value right here. Here it's FFDOE8. And let's check that out in the memory. So, telescope is this stack viewing thing right here that lets you see pointers and all that, which is really convenient for pointer operations and your what, where stuff. So let's go telescope from EBP. So look at what we have here. We have something pointing to another place on the stack, pointing to another place on the stack, pointing to zero. So when main is first executed, or libc start main, or something like that, EBP is zero, because I don't know, it's just magic. But we're like three or so functions deep off the main. So what you have here is pointing to EBP, pointing to EBP. So all these are EBP, it's like a chain of EBPs. So we could use that to nicely write to something else. Yeah? Yeah, because it's pointing to the save, unless you modify it, it's just pointing to the previous save EBP. And so there's a leave and then a ret at the end of every function. So leave pops EBP, pops top of the stack into EBP, and then pops. Well, then that sort of stuff. And then ret pops what's below that. So it's always going to be pointing, EBP is always going to be pointing at the next EBPs. So we could use this as a write what where primitive. So what we could do is we could pop this off the stack right to here, and then later on we could pop this off the top of the stack and then write to wherever we want, because we only have control over this address right here. Because we do have control over it, because we can use this to facilitate writing to this address, since it's pointing to there. So does that make sense? Because that's kind of the general idea of everything we're going to be doing today. So it's like a two-step, so that we can arbitrarily write to wherever we want. So you change, you write to this address, right? And then that changes this value that it's pointing to right here. So then you could change this value to whatever value you want. No, because all we're doing is traversing down the stack when we're popping from fig def. So, let me demonstrate that. Just continue. Let's do that. Well, it's just to make it look pretty. Those are static strings, as opposed to having whole bunch of numbers flying together. So you could actually see the top of the stack from here. So this is the pointer to our first printf argument. This is our second argument, or this is, I guess there's no actual second argument, but this is what's being interpreted as a second argument. And that's the first percent %p, 0xA, 0xA, and then 0x01, 01, and then all the way down to EBP right here. So if we do something like percent %p, percent %p, percent %n, right? So who wants to guess what this will do? Well, not in the EBP, too, the last day of EBP. Well, not three, I guess. It'll write however many values this is right here. So, let's watch that happen. So, I'm broken after the SNPrintf. So, you can see this right here is a saved EBP, right? Watch that change. Boom. So we just influenced, so this value right here turned into this value. So does everyone see how that happened? You pop three things off the top of the stack, percent %p, percent %p, percent %p, and then you do a percent %n to write to a pointer location. So pop this, pop this, pop this, pop this and write to that location however many bytes are written. So these three are consumed by the percent %p's, and then the percent %f, I mean percent %n, pops the next thing off the top of the stack and then writes something there. Well, EBP hasn't changed at all right now. Remember, this is just a saved EBP from a previous function thing. Previous spectrum. So, when this does a leave right here, it moves EBP into ESP so that stack consists of just this one value right here. And then it pops into EBP. So it pops this value right here into EBP. And then once echo, I believe is what it returns to. Yeah, it returns to echo plus 11. Once echo returns, it pops the next EBP value, next saved EBP value into EBP. So let's see that happen. Yeah. That's just. Yeah, because it's trying to write to this as opposed to. So if you only do 2% p's, this is the third thing that pops off the top of the stack, and then it tries to write to 0x0, which is that application call. Because you can't write to 0, to address 0. Yeah, you're popping the value in the stack. You're popping the value in memory onto, well, I guess into some random register, and then you're dereferencing that and writing to that address. So you're writing to the value on the stack. So this is the stack address right here. This is the actual address of where the saved EBP is, and this is the value. This is just the variable value. This could be anything, and what it does is it pops this variable value on the stack, from the stack, into whatever, and then writes to it. So it's taking a pointer from the stack and writing to that value, as opposed to writing to the stack directly. And that facilitates the putting a pointer as an argument to printf and writing to that. So does everyone have this straight? Because it's important. So I'll show you just real quick how EBP is doing stuff. So I'm going to continue. I put a breakpoint at echo plus 11, which is handy dandy right there. Now we're broken at echo plus 11. You can see that the stacks moved a little bit, right? EBP is now pointing to 108, which is this right here. So this is the actual memory location as opposed to being the variable in memory. So that value was popped, the value in memory was popped into EBP, and that's just how leaving a function works. So now a problem is, hey, we might be doing another leave soon, and the saved EBP value is 0xb. So anyone want to take a guess what'll happen? Yeah. So now let's watch it cycle. Look at EBP, right? Saved EBP is actually 0xe. So if I do this, it puts EBP into 0xe. So now return, and it keeps doing. So it's now trying to. This is just a GDB error. The stack frame's already messed up, so it's trying to read the stack, and it can't because it's bad. It's in a corrupt state. So now anything that tries to access anything via EBP is gonna have a pretty big problem. No, not yet. I'll show you how to get that. Okay. That didn't corrupt the stack too much because we're just in a not too bad location. So, the thing is, we haven't returned from the function that this saved pointer is. So, if we continued and actually exited from main, this is, I guess, main's saved stack, saved EBP. So, if we actually return from main, then it will have a problem. So, no data, sensitivity. Because it just tried to do a leave. So, it just tried to do a leave. So, what it did was tried to pop into EBP, and that just didn't work. It tried to dereference EBP and then move whatever value is there into EBP. So, you can't really dereference 0xE and have a good time. But that was just showing EBP and its fun behaviors. So how can we leverage that to get EIP? Well, glad you asked. Let me see what you're doing. So as you remember, there's EIP, saved EIP on the top of the stack. Generally, you just want to overwrite that, and you're in the clear, right? Just have control over EIP, and you can point it to wherever you want. Suppose I could do that first. Why not? But there are also a couple other cool things that you can do to gain control of EIP. There's a stack pivot, and what I did was I did a dot overwrite, and I'll explain all of that stuff as I get to it. So, in the real world, the stack's always going to be changing at different runs of the program, but with something like this, I guess not but, and something like this where it's just the same program in a loop, you're gonna have recurring stack values because it's reusing the same stack spaces, collapsing and reconstructing the stack as it goes through, as it loops through main. So, loop through main, call the function, just create a new stack frame as opposed to re-randomizing the entire thing. So, the idea would be to just leak values from the stack. And get the actual stack location. You can do that by just printing. So you could have, let's see, what's an interesting value? Let's say EBP. EBP is a nice thing to pop because you can get a decent amount of information from the stack because that's the actual base pointer to the stack. So it's the fourth one. So let's delete the second breakpoint. So here we have this right here. And what this is this is a location on the stack. So since it's always deterministic where we're going to be located, like offsets are always deterministic on the stack. I guess not always, but in this program, they're always deterministic on the stack because there's nothing that's modifying the stack and there's no wonkiness in function execution calls. It's all deterministic. So no randomness, no anything like that. So what you can do is you can use, once you have this value right here, you can use that to calculate the offset to some stored EIP. So what we want to do is overwrite this at this address right here. What you do in the real world is notice that so I'm just doing some calculation here. You have this address right here. And of course, this writes capital X, right? Yeah, there we go. And we want to find the offset to the saved EIP. So we do something like B108 minus BOEC. So that's a 1C, 0x1C difference between those two values. It'll always be 0x1C difference. So on a remote machine, what you can do is always subtract 0x1C from this value and find the location of a stored EIP. Everyone jiggy with that? Just for this program, yes. But if you have a leak like that where it doesn't re-execute the program or anything, then you could do that with any program and just get some sort of value. You just have to look at it once and see that it's that specific offset. So then you can calculate that minus 0x1c equals this. So now what we want to do is use some sort of write what where in order to write to this location. So we don't have any pointers to that, unfortunately. So what do we want to do? Let's make one. Yes. It takes a bit to wrap your head around all these pointers and stacks and stuff, but once you can see it, that's why I'm using this telescope thing, so that you can see pointers. So what am I doing? Yeah, no, I'm dumb. Sorry guys. Yeah, you can't really do that because it writes 4 bytes at a time and then And you can't have any value above 0x7f. It has to be a positive number in a 4-byte integer. So, yeah, that was a little stupid of me. But imagine that you could, and you could do that. So what I'm going to show now is a EBP pivot, or a stack pivot. But first, you have any problems? Let me check that out real quick. Is the stream actually working? Okay, yeah, stream's working. Yeah, so the stream's gonna lag because that's just how Twitch works. It's transferring a lot of data to a lot of people. Yeah. Okay, so now let's get back to business. So, one thing that would be nice to do is just change the stack location itself, since you can do that with EBP, right? Because EBP is controlling the stack. So if you pop something into EBP, then it thinks that's where the stack is. And the next thing that gets popped in there, that gets popped, is the return address. So if you point this at something that you control, then you actually have full control over the stack because the stack is whatever you put in there. It's sort of hard to explain without actually showing you. So this is a stack pivot. And Let's see. What address do we want to jump to? So we want to do this address plus a few, right? Because this is the RWX area right here. So let's do something like, just for fun. And then a bunch of A's just to see where it's going. So you could just do something like x/x here, and you can see there's a buffer in the VM map that's mapped as RWX. So we could have actual executable data there. One thing that's good to do is actually get a decent location where you're going to be able to have, I guess, something. So you're going to have some data, some percent keys or whatever, percent ends, format strings, just to exploit itself, and then you're going to have code or stuff in there. What you also need is the return address. And I'm not sure I can explain it without actually showing. So I'm just going to show that. So let's pick an address a couple bytes after this, just so that we know that it's a good place to write stuff. So let's say 20. So A, repeat 65 times. So there's just a bunch of A's right there. That's the middle of nowhere. Now we can do something like backslash. What would it be? I forget how these guys work. Look at that. Yeah, that's the idea. Yeah, that's, I'm right. Oh, yeah, there we go. That's right. Yeah. Yes. Just eat it. So this right here is making percent, so percent x is a format string for hexadecimal data. So if you do percent 1000x, it pads it. I guess that's just the specification to pad it. And if it has leading zeros, then it just doesn't print those. So it prints 1,000 characters without actually printing 1,000 characters and without actually having to type 1,000 characters. So now we have magic. So it says three right here. Sorry, that was unnecessary.
That's not what we want.
No. Yeah. So what we're now going to do is make it this right here. See, this is where exploitation actually gets fun. You get to do stuff. So you just buffer with those. I guess exploitation's always fun, but. So we're doing plus two, maybe A. It'll help if I actually just do this. So. Yeah. That's why obeys is 10 right here. And it had. It's BC. The iBase. If you specify the obeys before the iBase, then you could have both of them say 16, and it doesn't look annoying like that, but. Yes, but that just means the current base, pretty much. So once you say iBase equals 16, every number that you type into BC is in base 16. So if you say obase equals 10 and you want to get base 10, then that's actually base 16 in base 10. So yeah. So it did print out a decent number of characters, but doesn't always print out an exorbitant amount. No, there might be a better way to do this, but I'm going to get a quotation. So, you got a percent in right here. That'll write something. It's not going to be the exact one because you still have to account for things previously written. But I just use this because I'm lazy. No, because percent P, pop 1, pop 2, pop 3. The X pops one. Yeah, and percent N pops four. So you can see this is pointing at all these A's. So isn't that exciting? So now what I want to show you is this is the cool part. Just wait, guys. Let's see, how do I want to show this one? Yeah, that's it doesn't clear out the buffer, it just puts the 0x00 at the end of the memory. So you could do, let's do a top step. So you have, this is the format string, it ends in slash n. So, or it ends in slash n slash 0. So it ends in new line and then null terminator, because that's how things do. So it sees it as a number of strings. Right? That's exciting. You can see that it's sort of messed up because it's got a sort of a pointer. So it's 0x41, which is the end of an A, and then this is the null terminator, and then this is A slash M. So it just so happened that that messed some stuff up. But now for the cool thing. It'll just crash, yeah. So we continue. In order to make EBP this, we have to exit our main, right? That's just what we do. So, no data, sigset v, look at EIP. EIP is a bunch of A's. So look, we have control over EIP. Now, the fun part is showing how exactly that happened. So, when you leave a function, well, I guess when you exit a function, return from a function, these are all technical words. When you're done with a function, it does leave and then it does get, right? So, these are all in terms of, I guess leave makes everything sort of in terms of EDP, right? So, leave pops or puts ESP, puts EVP into ESP, so they're both equal. So ESP is now tainted with EVP. And then it pops into EIP, into EVP, and then it pops into EIP. So if you have control over EIP, EVP, then you can have control over EIP because the next stack frame, the next return, will have 4 bytes lower the return address. Let me actually do breakpoints so that you can see it much easier. I'm going to break right here. So now let's run it. So this stuff works because there's a bunch of data already on the stack. If you don't do anything the first time through, then it just is an empty stack and we don't quite have the stuff we need. But now we do, so let's put in that format string that I made earlier. No, it does. It cleans everything for you. But this program doesn't have the stack state that we want right when we start. I guess I could have showed you that, but it's not really too exciting. It's not important. So now let's put it on full screen here. Yeah, I guess let's show EBP equals. That's right. Yeah, of course. Okay, so we got that. Now this is our format string. This is going to write some address. Right, we got this. This is leaving the SNPrintf, I guess the make response function. So now we have EBP. The new EBP after this function is going to be pointing to this, and then after that it's going to be pointing to this, which is an R controlled buffer, which is cool because we're controlling EBP now. So let's continue. And now we're gonna stop because we wanna exit our main, exit out of main. Boom. So here's our breakpoint right here. So EBP is already this right here. You can see that top of the stack is this. All that good stuff. So now let's go to the next instruction. So EBP is now 0x41414141. ESP is this, and EIP is this current location right here, right? So what ret does is ret just pops off the top of the stack, right? Let me show you before. So the current stack location is this right here. This is the current top of the stack, and yeah, that's the stack. So, after leave, that pops the location of that into EBP, and then does a ret. So, the ret takes the value at the top of the stack, and makes that EIP, right? Because that's how ret works. So, what's at the top of the stack? A bunch of A's. Because... yeah, we just changed EBP to be pointing to our buffer, and then 4 bytes below that, buffer is where ret is. I'm not good with words. But can you see why this is happening? This is the current register state right here. Really? What is taking up all this space? What? I honestly don't see what's taking up all this space. If anybody has any idea what's taking up all this space, because something's filling up my hard drive right now. Did I stop? If I saw this one, I probably didn't have space to install it. Oh yeah, I do. But it could be logging. Yes, the VM's just something's eating up space for some reason. Like, between these DFs. What? Okay. Sorry guys, I don't know what's going on with my Ubuntu VM. Yeah. Well, I mean, I can see all this stuff. 8.8 gigabytes. So .cache. Upstart. Oh my gosh, I hate upstart. What is this doing? 8.7 gigabytes of upstart cache. I guess that's a folder. Do I not have access to this folder? Or is that... Is it... It's only on me. So, Unity session log is taking up a lot of No, it's going to speak better to be able to see through the camera. Well, thanks, Bob. That looked nicely. Well, I have to see what's at the end of the log, and it takes a while to see through an 8 GB file. I hate bugs that say this should never happen.
Well, no, that's just log.
Yeah. Can't this disk read at like 1 GB per second? Maybe it's just writing to it faster than it can seek to the end. I don't know. I've no clue. Oh god. Yes, it is, isn't it? No, at the end of line. What is this nonsense? It's just recording colons into my log file. So, I'll just remove that every now and then. Now I'm only using 40% of my VM. Good job. Okay, so how's everyone doing on the stack stuff? Because it was a stack pivot right there. Can everybody now stack pivot? Like a pro? Yeah, stack pivot. Everyone understand why EIP is going to equal 0x41, 41, 41, 41? I take that as a yes. There's a cycle. That's my next instruction. There we go. 6ID. So now we have control over EIP. And that's really exciting. Right? So now we can just do the easy thing and take the address that it popped and put stuff there. I guess, let's just do this the right way. There's a pattern here, right? Let's see. Make it 100. That's the worst looking pattern I've ever seen. Why? Okay. So, colon D, or control D. Control D is end of file, end of line, or end of file. UF. Okay, so now let's put this pattern in here and see what EIP equals. This is really the easiest way to figure everything out. It's the right way, I think. Okay, we don't need this yet, but let's do that. Just fixing up the stack, right? So, the pattern. Yep. So, now I want to do that format string, which goes way up here somewhere. Yes. So you need to have a better pointer if you're doing it remotely. But the thing about this is we're not doing it remotely, so we don't really care. It'll always be the same in GDB.
Or just have
well, now we're going to do at the end of the RWF. So like a knot set of addresses? Yes, that's what I do, except it's not going to be printing. Those percent %d differences aren't going to be differences, or probably not going to be differences multiple to 4. So it'll be a wrong offset. But what you could do is like run it 4 times and hopefully it's deterministic for each individual box or something. So something like that could work, yeah. But we're going to be precise here because we can. Yeah? You're gonna see.
Okay.
I'll show you. It's to see where exactly, like EIP equals AAAA, right? There's 100 A's though, so we don't know exactly where that would be. So now we can see which 4 bytes EIP is actually going to be, so we can see where to put the other stuff. So right here, we're writing all this stuff. So this is pointing at that length, that's perfectly fine. So continue, and that, do a leave, and now let's look at the top of the stack. So we have this right here, so EIP is going to equal this. So it doesn't really know it. So now you can do a pattern offset of this. Yeah, put in quotes. Oh, that's EVP. Oops. That's why I don't like spam, because it's way too many weird symbols. I don't like weird symbols in my patterns. If parenthesis, semicolon, parentheses. Yeah, it's not my thing. I could. Let's see how to use this. I don't know, can we? I thought this would be convenient, but... So ESP found no register contains pattern buffer. Well, no, EIP contains something that should be in the pattern. 2ASA. 2ASA. That was definitely part of the pattern. I guess, did it modify? Correct.
Yeah,
but like the same thing. Yeah, that's a good point. You mean a format string meaning? Yeah.
I'll fix that.
What do you
do?
I don't know. Yep. Oh, I don't have it on here anymore. I deleted it.
Yep.
Well, I just pasted it into the program itself. Right. Not into GDB, but into the program. No, printf. It might. I don't know if it does. I don't think it does because it's capital letters. I don't know if you have any capital letters. It's not that. So use your favorite pattern creation tool, such as Metasploit. So I'm done and these pattern create tools real quick. And I'm gonna put them on here. Oh, I hate a bunch of these. I think everything be arch. So here's my pattern offset and pattern create. Super fun stuff. Much more surprising. Okay, so what I'm going to do is run that again. Pattern there. Continue. Okay, I see what it's doing. It messed something up for you. Just in the data section. So I probably want to increase this number by a few. Yep, more than that. And then we're going to put the pattern. So the new continue, done, and I. So EIP is this, then pattern offset, to it. That says 33 bytes. So that's cool. Let's see if this actually works correctly. It should. Because this would be a lot more convenient. So I'm going to be honest. No, that's not pattern. Where did I get that from? Yeah, there we go. There's a pattern in there. End it. Pattern search. No, we'll just search contain pattern buffer. Oh. There we go. EIP found it offset 33. So it agrees. Looks like it actually does work. Woo, we have EIP. What? That's not actually a format specifier, so it's okay. Percent capital A? Percent capital A? I mean, it doesn't flash anything, so. So that is, it's still a bad one, but I guess it printed out enough characters that it's negligible difference. So at, that means at offset 33, we want to put a new EIP, right? And then we're good. And then we'll own it. So I guess is everyone good on that? Understand why EIP is being changed, where we want to put EIP, all that good stuff? No. What should I explain? What should I explain? This isn't doing a buffer overflow or anything. This is just, so this is the crazy long string in order to modify the presenter. Yeah. So that's the super long string that we're thinking of. So we have. Yeah, plus the garbage, plus EIP, plus shellcode. Or an offset and shellcode. If you really want to be lazy. So at this point, it's really a good idea to make like Python scripts and stuff. And that's where SOCAT comes in handy. Yeah, SOCAT. So SOCAT is sort of like a netcat on steroids. What it can do is it just can run a binary and act like a forking server. So you see how this binary actually prints out and takes in, send it in, send it out? On the competition side, you're connecting to it via netcat and then sending stuff and receiving stuff. So they're actually giving you the same binary they're using there, but they're wrapping it in SOCAT to actually be able to handle stuff. What do we have installed? Yeah. So SOCAT, TCP, personally, It was on port 4545. We use address for exec dot dash. So you got this, boom, and there you go. So what you can do now is connect that localhost 4545, and then it's the binary. So that's pretty exciting. Right? And it just sits there listening, waiting for people to connect to it. So, yeah, as I said, it'd be a good idea to actually start making scripts now, since... is there a way to, like, get rid of this? Not be in the same terminal window? Back into this one. There we go. Cool. So I like Python. My numbers aren't very pretty, but that's okay. So Python is good for Python too, right? Yep. So that's good. So right here, I'm creating a Python script to actually do all this. I'm going to cheat and use a similar script to actually do stuff so I don't have to look up all these function names because I always forget them, and that's just what I do in CTFs anyways. But it's nice to have some sort of remote exploitation example just to be able to, okay, so here's how I actually instantiate a socket. Here's how I actually do all this stuff. And tomorrow, I'll be showing more information about like clone tools that makes stuff easier. And that'd be great. So, for the script, we have something like so, import socket. So that brings in the socket library. It's nice to have global variables, because you have to specifically say that you know you're modifying them in order to modify them, like specify it as global in the function, so you can't actually impact too many things. So we have host equals localhost. I like single quotes, you can use double quotes if you want. Port is 4545. And it's nice to have a global socket, so that you don't have to keep passing it around. So that yellow thing is going to be annoying. Can you see it well enough? It says death. It's not going to... I don't want to change my whole... Vim. So, make a main. It's good practice to do this, just because you can have main at the top, and if main is just main at the bottom. So that's it. I don't know, I can't type or something. Okay, so now you got that. Sometimes I just like to set up specific things inside of ifname equals main. But you don't have to do that. I do this, though, since this is in the global scope already, it's just executing this outside of a function. It's a nice place to set global variables that have to be dynamically created or stuff like that. So I'm going to set socket, set up socket, socket equals socket, 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 dot, socket, script. And that's just a regular TCP socket. So we need to do s.connect. And then it's actually a tuple localhost for the hosting port. And then let's just do a print. It's nice to print out debug messages and stuff. And because you're actually executing a bunch of socket commands and all that, it's nice to wrap that in a try finally so that you can always close the sockets and not leave resources open. So now I got something like main. So let's just send what we already have here. That's just going to be this pattern and the format string. Pattern and the format string, I guess. Here's that pattern. Here's the pattern. Let's move the format string there. So here's the format string. So string, I guess let's call this like the first pivot. Okay, that actually needs to be a string. Then our, I guess, pattern could be, I guess, garbage. Remember, it's 33 characters in, so that makes it 33. Oh, actually, no, that's just 33. Sorry about that. So it's just 33 A's, and then we have REVP. Or EIP, sorry. And then what do we want that to be? So let's see. We're first returning to actually doing that, and that's that plus 33 is where our EIP is going to be. So then we'll want at least 4 more than that. So let's make it 22. So you'll want this to be our new EIP. So let's try my /x/2/x/4. Remember, little endian, so they have all this fun stuff. Yeah, I'm not going to do any struct up, any hacking stuff, because I'll save that for tomorrow. With clone tools and that sort of introduction stuff. Okay. So, now we're going to do, I guess, just see what happens when we actually execute this. Let's do a knob sled. So a knob sled is just a bunch of knobs that you put there just in order to execute stuff. Actually, what's a debugger interrupt? 2C? Okay. But GC might be a good way to do it. Oh, CC? Okay. Great. But yeah, we'll just do that interrupt. And then make an interrupt slide because that's super fancy. Hope I don't have any syntax. Wow, not actually hope I send stuff. So, s.send, we have to do some sort of, garbage. I'm just going to do stuff like send off. Yeah, good call. I don't know, but let's just be safe. Right. I just put it there because. Okay, so now let's check it out. This is not going to actually call me 6LB. That didn't work. Let's see here. I guess let's just do CC. Is CC a printable character? No. Is there any... So I don't know too much about PW besides just using it to do stuff. Can you make good shellcode in there? Or how do you do make good shellcode in there? But how do I get that into the actual program standard in? Okay. So let's change SoCat to not actually fork. I think that'd work, right? Yeah, and that just exits. I want it to crash. I just want to see a six tag. I'm gonna suck at this. True. Yep, there we go. Right. So, yeah, as you can see, there was a in-theory trap. That's just the debugger interrupt. That's true. Okay, yeah. So let's actually do that. So, those of you that are in here, we're gonna have a, let's make a fork again. So then you have to hit enter before it actually continues. So that's what happens. We don't have time to attach to it. What? Okay. So we have, which one's ours? Probably could have helped if I did it instead of Yeah, I guess it would be there. Yeah. Oh well. So it would be, yeah, this 09. Right? Well, I guess, yeah, it would be, thank you. I don't know if that would have some fun. So then you could just attach, right? Operation up. Oh, yeah. So the what? Oh, yeah, yeah. I guess first I need to make sure I'm not cooperating anything important. Good. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. What is it, tech P or tech A? Yep, there we go. Okay, so I can just continue and watch this happen. So we're just in this whole area of instruments, which is your XCC. So that's pretty much just proof we have arbitrary thread execution. So that's that. You can get some good shellcode, and I don't know if I have shellcode on this machine. That was a mistake. I was not. GDB tech P, I believe, for PID. So, this is really picky about shellcode because it, I guess, closed the standard in or something, and that caused problems. Okay, I have a nice description it here. I still think that worked. What we did. The shotgun is fine. Yeah. Yeah, that's how it works. I mean, but what do you mean by if you can find it?
Okay, so I'm putting up had a bunch of
continue. Oh. If it's a CC flood. Oh yeah, I think they should be the same numbers. What are you seeing? So you first go to here, then you continue, and then what?
I'm not
So what happens? No. It would be this guy. The SoCat's just a wrapper. I guess there's one SoCat listening for connections, and one SoCat's a wrapper for the network communications for the new port by name. Yep. So, like, this one was an old GDB one, but in the beginning it's not there. And then this one's the one being executed by SoCat. So you hit continue and then you hit enter in the Python script and it should save that. Save term. Yeah. So Python pauses and waits for you to hit enter. No. Let me check that out. So your EIP is actually 0xCCCC, as opposed to pointing to it. Check out the just memory around your stack. Sorry, we'll fix that later. Okay. So now I guess all that's left is to put shellcode in there and make it happen. So that's enough. So now let's debug why that didn't work. What? Yeah. Let's see now. Show you in a minute. So it executed, but I actually have to interact with it now. Okay, so As I said, you should probably clean it up as last time. This triggers the exploit because that triggers the pivot. It shouldn't really print anything out. Is it maybe a shell pump? Yeah, that's what I at least meant to do. So sending an empty string should have done that. What's ELF? Is it like a... Oh, yeah. Probably just send. Well, it might just work with nothing after, nothing before the new line. Because that and it just closes. Okay, so it looks like it's trying it. Is that the thing? This is what happens when I try to do stuff live. I think that's already happening. Yeah. is the Apple go-to fail bug.
That's
a problem. It may just be getting a sick turn before. Yeah, it's, I guess, same socket, but it's, it reopens dev.tty, and then just use unsend and send it out. I use that same shellcode in an example in a different exploit that I made. You know, I actually did this challenge, and it worked just fine. I have the stair right here. It opens dev.tty and then just accept these. Or, yeah, I guess close. Yeah. Well, there's no problem with that since we're using SoCat. It just wraps things in that. It doesn't. Yeah, I'm not too good with this, if I know, but it works for me. That's. I mean, I don't know why it's good. But what I see right here is it's not triggering the return from main until after something. I don't know exactly what that something is. But it's not where I wanted it to trigger it. I think we do need some accurate data. Yeah, it's going to sound like this actually lines. So it went up to 3.0, but then it's going to go down. You want to have a flash drive I can borrow? I'll just copy over some open file. What is this formatted? Yeah, thanks. So I can't detect this at all. That's what I would have formatted to. That's what I like. It's 33. Yeah. I can't trigger this. I don't know why. Well, it's hard to copy that kind of shell code and do it. I know. Yeah. Yeah, that's okay. I'm just redefining it. There's two different shell codes. What?
dimensions.
It works just fine with me. That is FBIPS only returning in the file once I close. I guess it's probably only returning all once I actually close the document. It's not getting ELF until I close the socket. You know, once I close the socket, I can't actually get any data back. Well, that's because the socket's closed. So I can't trigger the volume until the socket's closed. But I can't get data back if the socket's not open. I guess echoing. Oh my god. Maybe it could be like 0.00. I don't know. Well, the FKIPS has to return 0 or 0.00 or 0. So that means it doesn't read any data. And it usually just blocks until it reads data or until the socket closes. But that's 3 times at 1. So it doesn't actually break out of the main group. So the line keeps going. I guess, yeah. I mean, that's how it gets characters. Like it triggers it, but you need like a connect back shell or something for this exploit. Awesome. It's not like my exploit better, but yeah, still it did. you get it. Maybe I should stop doing these so late in the afternoon. I'm not so tired. Okay. Well. Okay. Okay, so I guess let's quickly do the Goth overwrites and get on with our night. Goth overwrite. So Goth is a place where you store relocation data, right? Because libraries are loaded randomly, right? With random locations every execution. The Goth is where it's stored, where each function is. So what you can do is, if Railroad isn't enabled, if it doesn't protect it, then you can overwrite those values, and whenever it tries to call a function, it instead calls your stuff. So, let's call it a night. I don't want to do another thing.